Welcome back to Life and Style. Remember to keep the conversation going on our social media platforms. KTN Life and Style on Facebook, KTN Life and Co-Style on Twitter and Instagram. SMS is 22840. The WhatsApp number is 0700-5747. Now, this is Living Up. Like I promised, we have Dr. Ngatia in studio and we are all matters infertility. Thank you for coming back on the show. Always
thank
glad
you.
To have you.
Thank you.
All right. Infertility, sterility, those are some of the things that are confused for the other. Maybe you should start from, you know, explaining or differentiating those two.
Okay. Thank you, dear listeners and viewers. You find infertility is a state where the couple cannot conceive, mm-hmm. Having lived together and having coitus for 1 year. That's what we call infertility or subfertility. The two can be interchangeable.
Okay.
Now, when you talk about sterility, that's different, mm-hmm. because that one means that the couple is sterile, or one of the partners is completely sterile and doesn't have the potential to conceive. So you find the two are different.
Absolutely. I think that is something that people need to know before you call someone sterile, and what they are is just, you know, infertile.
Yeah, infertile.
Okay. Now, who gets it? Because most of the times the ladies get the blame. And before we get to the risk factors, I think it's important for people to also know that it's not just the woman.
Infertility is a problem of both the man and the woman.
Yeah.
It is not for one person.
Mm-hmm.
In fact, in some studies, they find that for the known causes, the male factors take about 40%. The female factors take about 40 to 50%.
Mm-hmm.
The rest is both, or even the cause may not be known. In some, about 15%, the cause is unknown. So you find infertility is a challenge of both males and females.
So it's not just one gender.
It's not, of course, for our traditional African societies,
yes.
we tend to believe when the couple cannot conceive, the woman is the problem.
Mm-hmm.
And we have seen cases, even when I practice as a gynecologist, I've seen cases where the man has a problem, yet the woman comes up and tells me, Dr. Ali, let us continue and believe that I'm the one who has the problem.
So the woman takes the blame instead of now shifting it to where the real blame is at.
Yes.
Okay, that's pretty sad. So what are some of the risk factors? Because I'm sure there are a couple of ways that people can get infertile.
Yeah, they're quite diverse.
Yeah.
And you find if we start with the female factors.
Yes.
The commonest factors in our setup in this country are factors to do with the fallopian tubes, and factors to do with the ovaries.
Mm.
So you find the fallopian tubes, those are the tubes that convey the egg from the ovary all the way to the uterus.
All right.
And in a number of cases, they are blocked because of challenges to do with infection or what you call pelvic inflammatory diseases. Diseases that are sometimes sexually transmitted and they cause inflammation along that tube until it gets blocked. You find challenges also of the tube can be caused by problems like what you call endometriosis. Sorry for introducing medical terms.
It's a huge one.
Endometriosis is a state where the inner lining of the uterus proliferates away from the uterus, and it can proliferate even in the fallopian tube or even in the pelvic cavity.
Mm-hmm.
So you find that can cause infertility. Other challenges to do with the tubes can be congenital, or where somebody is born with a problem, for example, an absent fallopian tube.
Okay.
So in that case now the egg cannot be conveyed. Challenges to do with the ovaries include hormonal challenges.
Mm-hmm.
You find the ovary usually works on instructions from above. Instructions from above, we are talking about the hypothalamus, that's a gland in the brain, secreting some hormones to instruct the pituitary gland, which is also in the brain, on what to secrete to regulate the ovarian function. And that system, we call it the hypothalamus pituitary ovarian axis. If there's a problem in that axis, the hormones will be deranged and the ovaries will not function properly. They are not ovulate,
mm-hmm.
and that causes infertility. Other challenges are like you might have ovaries that are not properly formed. We call that agenesis, and that can cause infertility also. Moving on to the uterus. Uterus has its own challenges, which can also be congenital or born with or acquired.
Right.
And the acquired challenges of the uterus include problems like the growth that we get in the uterus, like the fibroids, can mm-hmm. cause infertility,
yeah.
which are common in our setup. Challenges like when somebody has had a cleanup for a pregnancy loss,
mm-hmm.
and the lining of the uterus can be damaged. We call that synechia, and that can cause infertility. Challenges of the cervix are also there,
right.
and infections in the cervix or operations of the cervix
mm-hmm.
may cause infertility. So you find for every part of the female system that you touch, you may get infertility. You can also get infertility because of systemic diseases in the woman.
Mm-hmm.
For example, diseases like diabetes,
all right.
and diseases of the thyroid gland, like if there is hypo or hyperthyroidism or mm-hmm. high levels of thyroxine, those ones may cause infertility. Renal diseases,
uh-huh.
yeah, kidney diseases may cause infertility.
Infertility as well.
Yeah.
There's so a huge chunk of things that
things
really
that can really cause infertility.
Yeah.
But having said that, I don't want to stop before I say that lifestyle
mm-hmm.
can cause infertility
all
in
right.
the woman.
Very important.
Very important.
Yes.
In the form of the woman who has a lot of animal proteins or
that's
animal fats.
Meat.
Yeah, meat especially.
Mm-hmm.
We tend to get infertility because of the reduction in the ovulation, and obesity is associated with the reduction in ovulation. So that one you need to know.
Yeah.
Yeah. So you find infertility mm-hmm. can be related to what we eat and the that type of lifestyle we live. So the
all of this, all of I realize you're mentioning the women and it scares
to
know that we
are.
Yeah. Yeah. Thinking about that as a woman, you're thinking, wow. What do I not do? What do I do? But we'll get back to that later. But
yeah.
what about the man? What are the risk factors?
The man has an equal share
okay.
of problems.
Uh-huh.
You find, let's start with the common challenges that we get in our setup.
Mm-hmm.
You find for men, we do analysis of semen
mm-hmm.
and we find sometimes there are no sperms
mm-hmm.
in the semen. Or even if they are there,
yeah.
they have abnormalities. Or they are reduced in numbers, you find that we need more than 20 million sperm meal to fertilize an egg. So you find the distance the sperms are going to swim, so to say,
mm-hmm.
Requires the best. And you need more than 20 million of them. So some men have oligospermia or reduction in the number of sperms,
mm-hmm.
and some of them the sperm is of low quality, so to say,
okay.
such that it is swimming in the wrong direction or has deformities in itself, and that causes infertility. Having said that, you find men can also have other challenges in the testes. You find some challenges can be congenital, or they are born with, and
mm-hmm.
others are acquired. Congenital problems in the testes is where you find maybe the testes is not able to start off the formation of the sperms. We
mm-hmm.
call that spermatogenesis, it's not there. And in that case now, there will be completely no sperm formation.
Oh.
Now, other challenges are like, for example, if there is mumps. Mumps is a viral disease
yeah.
that can cause orchitis or inflammation in the testes and cause future
mumps is the one that affects
yes,
your thyroid area.
Yeah, the mumps glands and all that.
Mm-hmm.
So you find if that happens, one can get infertility. Trauma to the testes can cause infertility.
Mm-hmm.
Congenital problems of the testes include, for example, where the testes is not properly descended.
Okay.
Yeah, such that it gets trapped. You see, the testes generally is formed as an abdominal organ, just like the ovaries.
Okay.
But for the woman, the ovaries remain intra-abdominal.
Mm-hmm.
For the men, the testes have to travel along a predestined path to get into the scrotum.
All right.
When it gets, doesn't get to the scrotum, then it's going to have a defect in that it cannot form the sperms. The sperms require to be formed in an industry where the industry is away from the body.
Oh.
So that when it is cold,
mm-hmm.
the scrotum contracts and pulls the testes to the to get some heat from the body.
It's a protective mechanism.
Yes, when it is hot, again, it moves the testes away from the body so that you boil alone. The testes is supposed to be an industry that's protected.
You know, listening to all of this, before we get to even signs and symptoms of knowing, you know, something is wrong, apart from the major one that I'm not being able to, you know, have children as a woman or as a couple, way back, our parents, our grandparents, they didn't have problems. You know, having children, they'd have 15 and more, and it was okay. Right now, even getting one is a struggle. You find people are trying for a year, for 2 years.
It's the more to do with the lifestyle.
The lifestyle.
You find the lifestyle has changed.
Mm-hmm.
Even for the men, again,
okay,
they accumulate a lot of, we accumulate a lot of fat. We take food that's not very healthy, and so we affect the spermatogenesis. Again, some men are into drugs, be it alcohol. Alcohol is a drug.
It's a drug.
And it hits very hard on the spermatogenesis process or that formation of the sperms. Smoking, the same. Other drugs like the heroin and the others, they affect the formation of the sperms. And of course, I have to mention, and this is very important, for men who use some steroids to build up muscles and appear good, those steroids inhibit spermatogenesis or formation of the sperms.
Wow.
So you'll find a man who is well endowed, but fertility becomes a challenge.
Absolutely.
So you find a lot has changed from our forefathers to our generation, and that's where we have a challenge.
A big challenge,
and of course,
actually,
in the kind of foods we are taking.
Mm-hmm.
Yeah, we are not taking foods that are rich in fiber.
Yeah,
we are taking a lot of fast foods, and when we do that, then our bodies are keeping a lot of elements that will inhibit the process of formation of the sperms. Not to forget that you may form the sperms and have what we call erectile dysfunction.
All right.
You may have the sperms, but you cannot donate them. So when that happens, the cause of that is because a good number of men have psychological problems and stresses of life.
Depression.
Yes, and the stresses of being pushed right, left, and center by life. And when they have erectile dysfunction, then infertility will definitely set in.
True.
So you find some have reduced libido, or the sexual drive is reduced, and some diseases, of course, are also in the increase.
Mm-hmm.
Talk about diabetes, mellitus, talk about hypertension, and the treatment of the same. So the drugs that we use to treat hypertension, they inhibit the sexual drive.
Absolutely.
So you can see the causes are varied. And
there are very many.
Very many.
And you've mentioned two signs that someone could know, you know, that probably something is wrong. If you've got an erectile dysfunction, then that's a sign right there. And if you're not able to conceive, that's a sign right there. What other signs and symptoms are there for someone to know or realize that something is wrong with them?
You see, infertility generally, the main thing is the couple you realize they have inability to get children, and you find that happens. We encourage people not to worry before at least a year is over.
Okay.
We don't want people to get married today and then after a month they're running to the doctor, or after 2 months.
Yeah.
We want
a baby pup. Baby pup.
We want people to take it a bit in a relaxed manner, just like our forefathers, and do it slowly. They are going to get babies. If there is a problem, that's when we come in as doctors and try to solve the problem.
Absolutely. Yeah. Now let's talk about solving that problem. So they come to you, tell you, Daktari, I'm not able to conceive. You do the test and you find out, there's an infertility issue here. How do you then go about treating that person?
It depends on the cause. As I mentioned, the causes are valid.
Yeah.
So treatment will depend on the cause. But generally, you find if a man, for example, has a problem with, we have done analysis of the semen and we found there's no sperm, for example. Mm-hmm. The next thing is to do hormone analysis to see, is he having enough testosterone levels and other hormones in the systems? And if the answer to that is yes, then we may have to think about, is there a blockage on the way? And then we have some x-rays that we do, we call them vasogram, to check on whether there's a blockage in the vas. And if there's a blockage, then the treatment will be to open that blockage.
All right.
If the problem is in the formation of the sperms or the quality of the sperms that are produced, then we have drugs and many of them that we give to boost the quality of the drugs.
Yeah.
If there's erectile dysfunction, there are drugs that we give to boost the erectile dysfunction or to boost the function of the male system. However, there are some cases where you find you do all that and you find the testis is not forming any sperm.
Yeah.
And that one, then you have to intervene by a different approach, and that is the role now of IVF or in vitro fertilization, or sperm donation, or many other interventions that we do.
Yeah, because I was going to talk about IVF and how it could be used.
Okay.
And are we open to that kind of thinking or that kind of solution? Kenyans.
Well, we still far off because IVF is still relatively new in our setup, but it is not new elsewhere.
Yeah.
And when it is new in our setup, then you find it's met with some degree of debate.
Yeah.
In that some will be religiously against it and say that babies should not be formed in the lab. You know, IVF, what happens is you get the egg from the woman.
From the woman.
Or the woman is stimulated to form many eggs in her cycle, then take those eggs, maybe like 6 of them or 5 of them, and they are kept in the lab. The man gives the semen, and that's now where if the man cannot give the semen, we can use semen from a donor.
From a donor, yes.
Yeah. And again, the semen is kept here, the sperms are washed out and all that. And then the two are mixed and they end up forming an embryo, or the egg is fertilized in the lab and again is put back now to the woman's uterus to continue growing there. Uh-huh. So it's quite debatable for some people, but some have already embraced it with good results. So that's what we call in vitro fertilization. In vitro because it's outside the body.
Yeah.
The fertilization is occurring of the body, and then the fertilized egg is put back.
All right. Yeah. So I am looking at our social media platform, and some questions for you. What medications? First of all, Esma, hello, Daktari, asante sana for having this conversation. Many people are living in the dark or not able to talk about it for the fear of stigmatization. Yeah. What medications are used to treat infertility?
Okay, as I said, they are quite valid.
Mm-hmm.
Like, for example, if you come to the side of the woman, if we find there is a dysfunction in the ovary,
Mm-hmm.
Let's say, for example, there is polycystic ovaries, or the ovaries are forming many cysts. We have various drugs that we can use. Some of them, we call them gonadotropin-releasing hormone agonists. Mm-hmm. We have drugs like letrozole. We have many drugs that we use to treat infertility. The commonest is what people know is the clomiphene.
Mm-hmm.
That's what they use commonly. And, of course, we have others that are valid and in the market. So we have many drugs we use, both for the males and for the females.
All right. Yes. Another question for you, Daktari. My name is Chris. I'm wondering if it's true that Mira can cause infertility or low libido.
That's a good question. You find Mira, we call it cat.
Yes.
Cat has some stimulants.
Mm-hmm.
And those stimulants, they enhance performance of the body systems generally.
Mm-hmm.
But at the same time, leach exhaustion in such a way that the body systems will be affected. So you find the from people who take Mira, and this it's painful to say this, but
yeah.
it has to be said at some point.
Yes.
We know that Mira is a good economic activity for our people.
Mm-hmm.
So we wouldn't want to spoil the economy of our people.
Yes.
But if the truth be told, when it's a drug, Mira is a drug, and once it is put in the system, obviously it will have its toll. It may not be as direct as drugs like heroin or drugs like smoking, cigarette smoking and alcohol, but it has a toll on erectile dysfunction and also on fertility itself.
All right. Yes. Very interesting question for you, Daktari. Now, Steve is saying, I recently went through radiation and chemotherapy for cancer, and it's affecting my performance. Yes. And then he's asking, could this be a cause for infertility or low sexual libido?
Yes, it can be a cause. Mm-hmm. You find generally radiation is likely to reduce fertility,
mm-hmm.
and also reduce the sexual drive itself. So radiation or even chemotherapy or any form of cancer therapy is likely to reduce the sexual drive and mm-hmm. also reduce the fertility. That's true.
We need to finish this conversation, but I have to ask, age, especially for a woman, is that something that we need to talk about or look at in terms of fertility? Because it's a huge concern. When you get to about 30 and you're not even dating, your mother is asking, unajua the clock is ticking.
Mm-hmm.
Uh-huh.
Thank you. That's a very interesting one. One thing that you should know is that age, as one gets older,
mm-hmm.
the number of oocytes or the number of eggs that are in the ovaries
mm-hmm.
keep on getting reduced by the day or by the year.
Mm-hmm.
So if they are reducing, and also their response to the hormones that I was talking about after being stimulated is also reducing. So you find the chance of a 23, the best age to get, of course, pregnancy is, we say, is quite theoretical, 23 to 28, but most of the people, they are forming their careers that time and all that.
Yes.
So you find if a 23-year-old girl or a 24-year-old girl
mm-hmm.
wants to conceive vis-a-vis somebody who is 35, obviously she'll win hands down. So you find age, as one gets older, the number of eggs reduce, and even the ones that are remaining, the response to the hormones reduce. So age is a factor in fertility.
Right.
However, somebody can conceive even when you are 40, 45, mm-hmm. and it's no big deal.
It's no big
for
deal.
For some people.
Absolutely. Yeah. Yeah. And before we finalize, this reminds me of something that happens a lot in people who've got a lot of money, and we've seen it a lot in Hollywood where the women go out to preserve their eggs.
Yes.
So that they are able to conceive later on, maybe
yes.
after 40 or 50.
Mm-hmm.
Is that advisable, Daktari?
I think that would be like postponing a problem.
Okay.
I would rather that one would use the eggs instead of
preserving them
to use them at a later date.
Okay.
Suppose there's a breakdown in the preservation systems.
Okay.
Uh-huh. So you find, I think it would be wise, instead of preserving the eggs and using them when you are 45, 48, why not mm-hmm. use them when you are 30, 31, 35?
Yes. All right. Yeah. Maybe you need to advise couples out there who are struggling with this, Daktari, and encourage them and even give them contacts to get in touch with you for more encouragement and even treatment.
You find there are people who are suffering from this problem, and when it has occurred, mm-hmm. it's good to give it a scientific approach.
All right.
And this means that we go step by step, we take the history, we do the physical examination,
mm-hmm.
we do the investigations, and determine exactly what the problem is before we embark on treatment. And then the treatment should be focused on the specific problem. And that way, we'll be able to solve some of the problems.
Yeah.
The other thing which I can urge our people to do, because 10 to 15% of causes of infertility, the causes mm-hmm. are known, and you do all the investigations, you find there's nothing. I would urge our people, let's take life a bit more positively. We have, like in this city of Nairobi, for example, you find some people, they never relax, they are always in a hurry, they are always trying to achieve this,
yes.
that, until they are stressed up. Such a person would be, it's like he's living a different kind of life from other people. So let's try to cool down and give ourselves a few minutes every day
mm-hmm.
and to relax and reflect on life and look at what it is all about.
All right.
Because sometimes we are like in a competition to get resources
mm-hmm.
and you want the best car, the best this, the best. You find sometimes that may not be the best. Let's not serve our careers. Let our careers be part of our lives, not the other way around.
And you always have these interesting quotes, by the way. Uh-huh.
So I think that's what I would tell our people. And I'm a gynecologist. I'm based here in Nairobi. I'm also the chairman of Department of Obstetrics and Gynecology in Kenyatta University. I have my private practice here in Kiabu.
Mm-hmm.
Dr. Ngatia Clinic is there. So one can always talk to me.
Asante sana, Daktari.
Thank you.
Always lovely to have you on the show.
Thank you, Mikael.
Well, like the Daktari has said, do not serve your career. Let it be part of your life, but do not live your life at the mercy of things that are pushing you around in life. Go ahead and take charge of your life. And last time you were here, you talked about how your life is an investment. And you need to put everything to make sure that you are the best person that you could be. Like I keep telling you every single day, you're the most important project that you would ever work on is you. So go ahead and do that. This has been Living Up. We're taking a very short commercial break. And when you come back, it's all about Beyond the Sports with Brian Suma. Don't go too far. I send you sana, Daktari. Yeah.
Thank you.